Lincoln has been carefully revitalizing its brand image over the past couple of years, from sad sort of nursing home level vehicles.
She's old.
Into a true expression of what they feel American luxury should be. And you know what? They've been mostly successful, especially now that the Nautilus has embraced the sort of new Lincoln design language and aesthetic, both on the outside and now for 2021 on the inside. Not to mention that Lincoln has the best named vehicle lineup in the entire automotive industry, bar none, that is inarguable. But is a brand new interior enough to make this $68,000 Lincoln Nautilus worth looking at? Well, I think a lot of it depends on your level of personal self-esteem. What's going on, everyone? Jax here, and today I am with the 2021 Lincoln Nautilus. See, people buy the German brands for their badges. You can convince yourself that it's for some sort of perceived performance benefit or intangible level of quality or something like that, but the fact of the matter is that's just not true. You are lying to yourself.
Liar!
People want a Mercedes because of the name. People want a BMW because something, something, something ultimate driving machine. People want Audis because, well, to be fair, because they're gorgeous. And people want Porsche SUVs because they're a Porsche.
Stupid.
Then you have Lexus with its sort of perceived level of quality, long-term reliability, and dealership experience. And you have Infiniti, which just says my credit score wasn't good enough for anything else.
Jog on.
This is exactly what Lincoln, and more specifically, models like the Nautilus, have to struggle with. Perception. The thought of spending nearly $70,000 on a midsize Lincoln doesn't really sit well with a lot of people, but you know what? Maybe it should. First of all, this Nautilus is powered by Ford's excellent 2.7-liter EcoBoost V6 engine, making 335 horsepower and 380 pound-feet of torque, which is enough power to get this Nautilus to 0 to 60 in about 5.7 seconds. That is competitive with the Germans priced in this sort of competitive range, and it's ahead of pretty much anything from Japan. It has an 8-speed automatic transmission, which is normal in this class of vehicle, and in this top trim level paired with this EcoBoost engine, it comes standard with all-wheel drive, which is, again, normal for this class. I averaged about 20 miles per gallon in mixed driving, which I think puts it kind of on the lower end of this sort of luxury class of vehicle, but it's definitely competitive. But to be honest with you, that's understandable and a willing trade-off that I would make given this engine's pretty epic performance. So if the difference isn't in outright performance, then it must be in the interior, right? Because that's where some American brands have sort of struggled in the luxury segment, is on the inside. No, not when it comes to the new Lincoln. This Nautilus has a frankly gorgeous interior, especially in this sort of two-tone spec. The leather is soft and sumptuous, and leather and other soft-touch materials extend well below the hip point, almost out of sight in some cases, meaning everything that your hand comes in contact with feels authentic and rich and appropriately luxurious. The new 13.2-inch center infotainment screen runs Sync 4, which means updated, more attractive graphics, as well as wireless Apple CarPlay. The headliner is fake suede, and like, it actually feels like fake suede. The 22-way adjustable seats are heated, cooled, and massaging. And there's a 19-speaker Revel, is it Revel? Revel or Revel? Revel audio system for you to enjoy the latest from Olivia Rodrigo. Wait, would I get demonetized if I just started singing that song? I better not try it. I have a voice like an angel, but it's gonna have to wait for later. There's also 37 cubic feet of space in the rear cargo area, which is class competitive, and it's enough for Macy, Madison, and Morgan's lacrosse gear. All right, here we are behind the wheel of the Lincoln Nautilus, and right off the bat, this car rides incredibly smoothly. This is exactly how a Lincoln should drive. And I mean that in the best way possible. This car is so comfortable, but it never crosses the line into feeling unrefined or squishy or uncontrolled. There's not a lot of head toss. There's just supreme comfort. And I actually really dig that about this car. The steering, for example, is, I would call it appropriately light. It is light, but it's, you know, accurate enough. And I don't really think this car needs to pretend that it has aggressive, precise steering. I mean, you can put it in sport mode and it does sharpen things up a little bit, but the steering to me feels appropriate for this type of vehicle. And that really kind of sums up the entire Nautilus experience. Similarly, the throttle and brake calibration are spot on, like just spot on for this vehicle's sort of intended purpose. It's mission statement, as I like to say. This is a luxurious daily driver that is not trying to be one of the Germans. It is trying to give you the quietest, most comfortable experience in your daily life. And that is exactly how everything is dialed in this car. And I dig that. I dig that sort of like single-minded purity of purpose. This car isn't pretending to be anything that it is not, and I am 100% okay with that. Vehicles that try to be all things to all people tend to fail at some or many of those things. And the Nautilus is not doing that. It's not pretending. There are no pretensions of handling your sportiness. Now, that being said, this car does have a fairly great engine. The 2.7 liter EcoBoost V6 twin turbo pumps out 380 pound-feet of torque, and you can definitely feel it in this car. It is plenty for your daily life. Now, we just turned onto the handling road, and the first section here is really rough, really bumpy. This car is riding on 21-inch sort of turbine-styled wheels. And one of the things that I think is the most interesting about it is how easily it dispatches both the sharp and soft bumps here. Coming around the first kind of sharp turn, there is some body roll and understeer. I think that's kind of the price that you pay for this car's extreme comfort. But the composure overall, to be this soft and this composed, is where Lincoln has hit a real sweet spot. Coming up to the big bump, and that was it. There's a little bit of a secondary motion there, but you know what? Considering this car's highway ride, which is phenomenal, I drove it across Atlanta the other day, going to a car show, of course, and it was unbelievably comfortable, and the radar cruise control works impeccably well. Not to mention, by the way, These seats are some of the best. They are some of the best. They're like 22-way adjustable. The bolsters all can be adjusted. They feel fantastic. They're actually kind of firm, but incredibly supportive. I love these seats, I really do. I think this car is very comfortable to drive. Now that being said, the driving position for someone my height is a little bit whack. The steering wheel doesn't quite come out far enough. The dead pedal is the size of an 8-year-old's foot. It's clear that like it's based on the Edge platform. There's some compromises being made with that. I've probably already said that in the video, but it's okay. Like I'm still really comfortable driving this car. And you know what? The engine, yeah, like it gets going. Like that's about 80 miles an hour and like that. I mean, that's impressive. And again, we're not trying to handle here. We are gliding over the surface of the road. It's just phenomenal. I really like this car way, way more than I expected to. Actually, I need to slow it down. This car can build up speed pretty rapidly. And the speed limit's like a solid 40 here. So we're gonna bring it back down into normal, appropriately legal limits. I will say that sport mode really sharpens up the throttle and actually, you know, gives a little liveliness to the daily drive experience. The 8-speed automatic is totally fine. It is literally invisible in normal driving. But if you do floor it like I did, it's a little slow to kick down even in sport mode. So I'm okay with that. Like I said, it's not trying to be sporty, but maybe just a little crisper response would be appreciated, especially considering the capabilities of this power plant. Also, because this is the black label trim, this has Lincoln's Copilot 360 plus advanced super mode, so it can do the self-parking. It's got all the safety systems. It's got radar cruise control. It's got literally everything. It totally has your back. I think Ford and Lincoln are crushing it with their safety systems and their sort of active and passive safety systems. And I really have been enjoying driving these Ford and Lincoln cars over the past couple weeks because they just feel very complete. They feel very well-rounded in that sort of department and sort of the safety and convenience department. The 12.3-inch gauge cluster is nice. It's, you know, like all elegant looking. I wish it was a little more visually interesting. It's like maybe a little bit boring. You can't really, I don't know, do anything super cool to it. It doesn't have the kind of moving dials like the Lexus system or the virtual maps like the Audi systems, but like it looks good, it's bright, it's functional. You can call up pretty much all the information that you'd want to see. I also like how sort of bright and airy the cabin is thanks to this enormous moonroof that stretches over the top. It just feels so open in here. It feels so luxurious in here, to be honest with you. I think that's the thing I've enjoyed about the Nautilus the most this week is that it feels legitimately luxurious. I mean, this is a nearly $70,000 SUV and it feels like one. Overall, I'll say this about the Nautilus driving experience. It is frankly impressive. If you come into it with your expectations in check and you are expecting this Lincoln to treat you with sort of all the comfort and convenience that you desire, and you don't think that you're buying a Porsche Macan or a BMW X5 or something like that, then I think you are going to be incredibly happy with the Nautilus. The driving experience is great. I mean, just great all around. I've been pleasantly surprised during this week with the Nautilus. And you know what? I just can't say enough about these seats. I complain about this. Go back and watch my other videos. I've got a messed up back. It is very easy for me to get uncomfortable, to get out of whack in seats that like the F-150. The seats were great, but like I just had this spot in my lower back. I was able to like literally dial it in this car with the bolsters, and it's been supported, and I feel fantastic all week. It's just unbelievable. This car is a lot better than people give it credit for. I'll say that. So after all that, should you buy a Lincoln Nautilus? Well, to be honest with you, during my week with the Nautilus, it really surprised me, kind of like the Lincoln Corsair did last summer. Link in the description for that review. It's very good at its intended function, and it looks really nice inside and out now. I have a few criticisms that might help to explain my final verdict, if you'll bear with me for a minute. The first two are the most egregious, so let's take a look at those two first. First of all, the backup camera and surround view camera system are absolute trash. Like, they are laughably bad in a vehicle of this price. Like, whoever okayed it, whatever finance guy bean counter okayed a camera of that low quality should be immediately injected into the center of the sun. They're unacceptable in a vehicle that costs nearly $70,000. I just had the Ford F-150 PowerBoost last week to test, and the camera system in that was gorgeous. It looked high definition. It looked expensive. Why does this one look worse than a Sega Game Gear?
Get a Game Gear.
The second criticism is that the Nautilus is incredibly quiet inside, impressively so, which made the whistle of air rushing past it even more noticeable. There was something on the exterior. I'm not exactly sure what. I narrowed it down to somewhere at the top of the A-pillar, maybe the windshield surround, that was creating an extremely noticeable whistling sound at speed. And by at speed, I mean like anything above 25 miles per hour. See, it's these kind of little details that matter. These little details that make the difference. And when we go back to the beginning and we talk about perception, these are the kinds of things that sort of mar the perception a little bit. And it's why people think so highly of the German and the Japanese competition. Is that really fair? Maybe, maybe not, but you know it's true. Oh, and my last complaint, it's not really a huge deal. It's just that there are certain packaging restraints that come with the use of the Ford Edge platform. The dead pedal is too small for someone of my size. It's really sized for like an infant's tiny hoof. It's not really sized for a size 14 shoe. And putting the seat back to where I need it at 6'6" results in me sitting sort of behind the B pillar, which I've told you in previous videos is kind of like a packaging trick that automakers can use where I can have enough leg room, but really it was never intended to go back that far. And this is made even more obvious by the fact that the steering wheel doesn't actually extend far enough out to cover that distance, and it's not like I don't have long arms. However, these are the issues of a freakishly tall person, so you might not even care about that one. All that being said, I still really like this vehicle, and I mean that. I really like it a lot. And while I might not buy one new for $70,000, I absolutely would consider picking one of these up off lease with about 15 or 20,000 miles on it where the original owner had taken the initial hit of depreciation. Its combination of style, rich sort of luxurious substance, and solid driving dynamics, comfortable driving dynamics, really might win you over. And if you haven't taken a look at sort of the new Lincoln since they've reinvented themselves, you absolutely should. If the next generation of Lincolns leaps forward as much as this one has, then it will be 100% competitive with any and all of the German and Japanese luxury brands. Guys, thanks so much for watching this review of the Nautilus. I hope you found it valuable or at the very least entertaining. I'll be 100% honest with you. I've been shocked by the two Lincolns that I've had in the past year, how good they are, how rich they feel, the attention to detail, the separation from their sort of Ford platform mates. It's incredibly impressive. And to be honest with you, as much as I make fun of a lot of different brands and sort of stick to stereotypical tropes, I do love to applaud a brand when they're sort of on a roll and they seem to be winning. And honestly, Lincoln is doing a fantastic job, and I wish them well, and I hope that their products continue to evolve in such a compelling manner, because this is a great vehicle that has a lot of positive attributes. And while I might not say that it's worth its full price brand new compared to its competition, you definitely should take a look at it, and I would 100% consider picking one of these up on the used market, if the used market ever returns to normal. Because at the time of filming, the car market right now is absolute insanity. So enjoy these videos, and I hope they bring you some entertainment. If they do, please click like, please click subscribe, ring the bell for notifications, and I will catch you in the next review. Ride safe and drive safe. I'll see you soon. Peace. visibly sweating because I don't have the AC on. It's a good thing this thing has great climate control. Ugh, gonna need it. People can't talk a little quieter. Seriously. You know, run your damn mouth.